Gentlemen, thank you very much. Thank you for that lovely introduction. I really appreciate that. I especially like what you said about making things strange, because I think that as a novelist, that's our job, is to take the familiar and make it strange. And I think Ruth and Simon talk about that, and it's always been the case to look at things that are familiar and make them strange. And I now want to thank the Asian American Studies Program, and I guess it's Women and Gender Studies as well, and then the English Department, right? Which is actually very fitting for the topic today, which is hybrid vigor. And certainly these amalgamations, these collaborations, interdepartmental collaborations, are an example of hybrid vigor. It's kind of like an exquisite corpse. Have you ever played that game, Exquisite Corpse, where you, one person, how does it work now? One person writes a line of poetry, and then you fold it down and pass it to the next person who writes a line, and it kind of goes around. It's kind of exquisite corpse. I do a lot of speaking at universities and colleges, and very often it will lead to a kind of a multidisciplinary group of, once again, English, creative writing, women's studies, Asian American studies, film, media studies, and I'm also a filmmaker and I've worked in television for many years. Environmental studies, agricultural studies, because of my interest in food. So I think, once again, this idea of hybridity is kind of inherent in the work that I do and the kinds of things that I like to write about. So today, I'd like to do a kind of a hybrid exercise here. I'd like to do a couple of different things. I'd like to read a little bit from My Year of Meats, which is my first novel. And I think I'd like to do that because I always find it interesting to hear the way a text sounds in the author's mind. So it's always a little bit different. So I'm going to do a little bit of reading from My Year of Meats. And the piece that I think I'll read is a piece that, once again, is sort of about this notion of hybridity. Then I think I'd like to talk a little bit about my own background and sort of what I perceive as my own sort of hybrid cultural and racial background and how that influences the kinds of things that I do. But I also want to make sure that we save room for the conversation part of this. So I'd really love to, at the end of this, have enough time so that we can really engage in a conversation. And if you have questions, please feel free to ask them. We can talk about anything you'd like. We can talk about hybridity as a strategy for storytelling, or about food politics, or gender politics, or race politics, or anything else, or just storytelling. But first, I'd like to start with something a little bit different. Okay. One of the examples of the way that I use hybridity in my work is I introduce a lot of scientific and technical facts and information into these fictional constructs, these novels. The novels are not science fiction per se, but they're fiction that that contains science. So I use science in the service of fiction. And as a result of this, I often get to participate in these kind of strange hybridized events. 3 weeks ago, I was invited to an international symposium in Sendai, Japan, which is up in the northern prefecture, at a place called Tohoku University. And the group that invited me was the Materials Integration Institute, which is one of the top materials research facilities in the world. The title of the symposium, international symposium, was Citizens and Science for a Sustainable Future. And this was a group of Japanese material scientists and researchers, and then some of us coming from abroad, educators and environmentalists and writers and artists. So we were the citizens, they were the scientists. And the idea was that we would get together and exchange ideas and hopefully come up with ideas for a sustainable future. So let me tell you a little bit about the scientists. They were top-level researchers, research scientists, engaged in research in areas like solar technology, ceramics, hydrogen energy, biomaterials, electron microscopes. scientists were looking for us, people like me, to share some insight into a sustainable vision for our planet. Well, needless to say, I felt entirely useless. The topic that I was assigned that day, was keeping our minds open to difference and diversity. And my feeling, of course, was that surely these scientists would invite someone like me to their conference, right? Certainly had open minds and were very open to difference and diversity. So what could I possibly contribute to this dialogue? But since they were scientists, I decided to start with an experiment. It was a thought experiment, or in German we probably call it a Gedanken experiment. And it was an experiment in keeping the mind open. And so if you don't mind, I'd like to do the very same experiment with you here. It doesn't take very long, and it isn't difficult, and you don't have to be a material scientist to do it. Is that okay? Everybody gave you this? First thing, if you can all put down everything that you hold. Put down. Are you all comfortable? Temperature-wise comfortable? Do you want to take off your clothes or anything like that? Great. So impressive. Everybody, is everybody okay? desensitize us to the wordings of our minds. And so that when a judgment arises, you know, you notice it when you can let it go. Somebody says something that you don't agree with, instead of closing your mind and blocking that, you can greet that idea with curiosity, you can greet that person with curiosity instead of aversion. In the same way that you can constantly, you know, that you can conscientiously relax your muscles, you can also, you know, relax the tension in your mind. And the reason that I wanted to start with this is that I think, honestly, it's probably the most valuable thing I've ever learned how to do. So it's incredibly useful to me. But it's also a way of sharing a little bit with you the physical sort of feeling of what it is like to be a novelist. Okay. This is kind of what I do. I mean, obviously, I do more than just sit there with my eyes closed. Though, actually, I do spend a lot of time sitting with my eyes closed. But the whole idea of fiction writing is a contemplative practice, and it's a, you know, it's a meditative practice. And what I do is I study my own mind as a model for my characters' minds. And so I'm tracking my own thoughts, my own judgments, my own beliefs, and using them, you know, my likes, my dislikes, and using my mind as a model of sorts for my characters' minds. And then I use this to create a kind of thought experiment called a novel. And this novel, which is a fiction, then goes out into the real world. And it's almost like an invitation to other people to participate in a similar kind of contemplative activity, which is called reading. And so then my goal as a writer is to spark my readers' curiosity and to invite them to open their minds to the world of the story, as I have. So that's my other reason for starting it, because I think it's a nice way of sort of understanding the kinds of the beginnings of the way that your mind tells stories, that your mind is constantly generating stories about who you are and what you like and what you don't like. So, with that in mind, I'm going to read just a little bit from my year of meets. And I think I'll read the first section of James. People, has anybody read the book in the past? Anybody? Okay, good. That's good. Then I think this will be an introduction. Okay. So this is a book, My Year of Meets. It's the first novel that I ever wrote. So, and the character here is Jane. Meet is the message. I wrote these words just over a year ago, sitting right here in my tenement apartment in the East Village of New York City, in the middle of the worst snowstorm of the season, or maybe it was a century. On TV, everything's got to be the worst of something, and after a while, you stop paying attention, especially that year. It was January 1991, the first month of the first year of the last decade of the millennium. President Bush had just launched Desert Storm, the most massive air bombardment and land offensive since World War II. The boiler in my building had blown, my apartment was freezing, and I couldn't complain to the landlord because my rent was overdue. I had just defaulted to a vegetarian diet of cabbage and rice because I couldn't find a job. Politics and weather aside, the rest was fine. I mean, I was doing the starving artist thing on purpose. I wanted to be a documentary filmmaker. Who could find work in a climate like this? When the phone rang at 2 in the morning, I didn't bother to answer. It was unlikely to be a job offer at that hour, so I let the answering machine pick up. But then I recognized the voice. It was Kako, my old boss at the TV production company in Tokyo, where I had gotten my first job translating English sound bites into Hindi Japanese subtitles. Now, he said, he had a new program and could use my help. I threw back the covers and dived for the receiver. After a brief conversation, we hung up. I wrapped myself in blankets, huddled over my computer keyboard, and, blowing on my fingers to keep them warm, wrote the following. My American wife. Meet is the message. Each weekly half-hour episode of My American Wife must culminate in the celebration of a featured meet, climaxed in its glorious consumption. It's the meet, not the missus, who's the star of our show. Of course, the wife of the week is important, too. She must be attractive, appetizing, and all-American. She is the meat made manifest. Ample, robust, yet never tough. job and keep me both meat fed and employed for over a year. My dear Faith, it changed my life. I know what happens when something rocks your world and nothing is ever the same after. My name is Jane Takagi Little. Little was my dad, a little from the farm of Minnesota. Takagi is my mother's name. She's Japanese. Hyphenation may be a modern response to patriarchal naming practices in some cases, but not in mine. My heart is a thrust of pure superstition. At my christening, Ma was stricken with a profound oriental dread at the thought of her child bearing an insignificant surname like Little through life. So at the very last minute, she insisted on a name of hers. Takagi is a big name, literally, comprising the Chinese character for tall and the character for tree. Ma thought the stature and eminence of her lofty ancestors would help equalize Dad's Little. They were always fighting about stuff like this. It doesn't mean anything, Dad would say. It's just a name, which would cause Ma to recoil in horror. How can you say just a name? Name is very fussy. Name is space, also a name. Jane represents their despair at ever reaching an interesting compromise. know, amongst people like myself, mixed blood people in Japan, now we use the expression double. And another note about Japan that's kind of interesting is that the title of the sixth Harry Potter novel, Harry Potter and the Half-Blood Prince, Harry Potter and the Half-Blood Prince, was translated in Japanese as Nozzle the Prince, which means the enigmatic prince. And this is because there's no way of translating half-blood into Japanese in a way that's not offensive, okay, or awkward. Konketsu, the word konketsu, is a very disparaging term, and the word hafu, or daburu, refers specifically to people who are half Japanese, okay? Which, of course, Harry Potter is not. So they end up having problems translating. So here are two more synonyms for this concept of a hybridized person, half-blood or mudblood. Okay, thanks to Harry Potter, now we can talk about half-blood and mudblood. And in Harry Potter, too, there's, you know, Harry Potter, Severus Snape, and he who shall not be named are all excellent examples of hybrid vigor, right? Because they all have special and sort of superhuman powers. So this is good news, okay? Things are looking up for the hybrids. Hybrid vigor is also what you see behind recent fads in designer dog breeding, okay? And why now the pet world is overrun by labradoodles and cockapoos and puggles and schnoodles and things like that. This is kind of, this is all, you know, once again, hybrid vigor, kind of photoshopped genius. According to the style section of the New York Times, ambiguously ethnic is now trendy. And this is, of course, thanks to hybrids like Mariah Carey, Tiger Woods, Keanu Reeves, and, of course, no, Barack Obama. So, any luck, we might even have a new vigorous president. So, Barack Obama is, of course, once again, maybe that's responsible for his, you know, his success as hybrid vigor. In the plant world, too, hybrids are also very popular. And I'd say that probably most commercially produced food crops today are the result of various types of technologies of hybridization. Hybridized varieties grow faster, they produce greater yields, they're hardier, they're more resistant to unfavorable weather conditions and pests. And I'm not an expert on plant or animal breeding or genetics, but I find the field to be extremely interesting and worthy of study. However, because I'm a novelist, my take on this notion of hybrid vigor and hybridity is purely metaphorical, literary, and personal. So I am, you know, a hybrid offspring of an Asian mother and an American father. And I think I use this term ironically as a kind of a joke, because actually I'm a very poor example of hybrid vigor. I have probably a little bit more patience than my mother ever had, and I'm probably more sure-footed than my father, but in terms of intelligence and resilience and all of that, I think they had me beat. But as a metaphor, I've still found this notion of hybrid vigor to be very useful in describing the kinds of little boundary crossings and transgressions and sort of generic interbreeding that I try to practice in my film and in my writing. It's kind of bad manners in novel writing circles to read from your reviews, but I'm going to which, do you know what this is? It's this extremely ultra-elite, ultra-conservative American patriot organization that supports things like the War on Terror and the Project Patriot and initiatives to distribute American flags to the Iraqi people, things like that. I grew up in New Haven, Connecticut, okay, in the 1960s, during the height of the anti-Vietnam War movement. My father taught in the anthropology department at Yale. And the anthropology department was right around the corner from the Peabody Museum of Natural History, so I grew up sort of playing in the Peabody Museum, sort of at the foot of the great brontosaurus sculpture, sort of playing tag along the great murals of the evolution of man. There wasn't a large Japanese or Asian community in New Haven when I was growing up, except for within the anthropology department. And for some reason, and I'm not sure exactly why, many of the white male anthropologists had wives who were Asian. This was back in the days of sort of before identity politics and political correctness. And so people used to call Asian people Orientals, right? And I remember that there was a joke circulating around the department and at faculty cocktail parties that in order to get tenure in the Yale anthropology department, you had to have an Oriental wife. Which is kind of funny because it was the Oriental wives who were telling this joke. And they were the ones who thought it was funny. So we had this kind of, we formed a little, kind of a little club, you know, these, you know, exotic Oriental wives and these half-bred, you know, half-Oriental, half-anthropological children. And I think that the demographics of that department was probably formed my first awareness of identity. And I see now that it was sort of quintessentially postmodern sort of awareness. I was both the observer and the observed, both the self and the other. I was the hybrid daughter of an anthropologist and his exotic object of study, his field trophy, if you will. And so right from the start, there was a, you know, I think this kind of predilection for self about 25 years to find my narrative form. And when I did finally find it and start writing novels, I found myself writing about these hybridized, hyphenated protagonist characters, who somehow were, part Japanese, part white, and somehow sort of bridged this, this world. And it's not just the characters in the books and the films that I've done that are hybrids. The theme of hybridization Okay, sorry. Anybody else?
Yeah. I'm just curious then, how you see, very much what you were saying about when you were growing up, people seeing Jack and Lisa grow. I mean, it's one thing, I mean, it isn't one thing, but like, I haven't really formulated the question, but like, it's one thing to say that, you know, this peach, for example, or the heirloom tomatoes, right? But this is like a hybrid, and it has this like hybrid vigor attached to it. But what about the, to me, really reductive instinct of looking at a person and saying, oh, you're Asian? And like, how do you negotiate that desire on one hand culturally to have this like enhanced hybrid, but still this person-to-person interaction where it's still about, you have to be one or the other? Because no one's going to say, oh, this peach has to be like the original peach in the same way that someone. That's my question. I don't really know what it is.
I got it.
Yeah, I understand. We're always making those assumptions. You meet somebody and they have to fit in, and it's like, what do you do when, you know, it's going beyond just a half Asian, half American. What do you do with somebody that's brought up in America but is half, you know, half Chinese and half
doing
Japanese, and then she always referred to me as being half.
Right.
When I was a little kid, I was really thinking, well, how, where is division? You know, is it top to bottom or is it side to side? You know, how is this possibly? I mean, I really did feel like one of those cows with the dotted lines, you know, sort of like the Japanese half and the American half, something like that. And it's, you know, so I mean, I think that too, we do look to, you know, we do look to our heritage to explain ourselves, or you know, people, other people look to our heritage, you know, your heritage to explain you. radical, you know, evil, right? And so in that sense, of course, every character, every element of the story is got to be on some level, somewhere autobiographical, but not perhaps in the overt ways that, you know, those overt identity ways that, that you know, are so easy to point at.
So good is about the individual body's experience of the corporate body.
Exactly.
So that there is a way that you can enter the story. I haven't read your second book, but I love the so much. Because I felt like it was a text that talked about how we all do experience every day and sort of, I mean, it put words to that experience of the corporate that overtakes the individual body.
Which once again goes back to this idea of easy distinctions and easy identification. Because, you know, we're constantly talking about things like the political and the personal as though those things are, you know, oppositions, as though they are, you know, some sort of binary oppositions. But in fact, we know that's not the case. I mean, feminism has taught us that, you know. And you know, and so for example in my year reads, I mean, when the plot hinges around a particular hormone called DES, which is a form of a drug that was given to cows to, as a growth enhancer, to make them gain a lot of weight very quickly. virtual and Second Life, so that there's this kind of constant erosion of the real, right? Of the sense of what is real and what is firm and what is absolute, what is a body, in fact, right? And I'm just speculating here, but you know, there's it's very interesting because having just come back from Japan again, I'm very dismayed at the way that technology is, because so many people, the only way to really make a living in Japan now is to move to a city. You can't really make a living in the country anymore. And so as a result, everyone's moving to the cities, and it's very, very crowded in the cities. And you know, so the sense of, you know, sort of personal space is very kind of rigidly defined, but it's also, there is a kind of, as a result of technology, a kind of a virtual layer to people's experience that is always present. So that, for example, you know, on the train, we see it here too, everybody's on cell phones, plugged in iPods, you know, we're always hooked into our technology, and I'm, you know, one of the worst offenders. But, you know, but there is this constant layer of sort of virtual reality going on all the time, right? Concurrently, there's an increasing amount of, just vastly increasing suicide, okay? And in a way, and this is just something I've been thinking about, and I have absolutely no data or anything else, it's just, you know, it's just a thought, but the sense that, you know, that in this kind of increasingly virtual world, that the way to sort of, to make a statement that is, you know, absolutely, positively real is to kill yourself. That's the way to sort of, you know, to break through virtuality and to make a statement. It's sort of beyond cutting or beyond any of the other kind of body modifications that you might do. That is the ultimate in sort of real life activity, is to end it, right? And so, I mean, it's just, you know, it's sort of, I hesitate to put it out there, but right now in Japan, I think that something like there's a suicide every 15 minutes, and the suicide rate in Japan is the same as in the United States. Not the rate, sorry, the number of suicides per day. Okay, I mean, and a huge difference in population here. Okay, so I mean, it's really, it's a little, and a lot of this is being attributed to, in Yeah.